Yeah, we should be in the second part of the recording.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so now let us discuss ceilings in the roofline model. Okay, so roofline model itself is bottleneck analysis. That means what is the maximum? And now I'm telling you, okay, sorry to inform you that even before you hit this roofline, there is one more ceiling, because that's the reality, right? So now let us discuss computation ceilings and communication ceilings in the roofline model. Okay, these are some of the acronyms we will use: AI for equating intensity, DP, ILP, FME. Just so okay, let me also put some more slides here. Okay, yeah, so we'll discuss the communication computation ceilings. So let us take example of Opteron processor. It is it's a dual socket. Okay, it has three prefetchers. Here we have total of 8 cores. 4 cores are here, 4 cores are here. It is a two-way SIMD, double precision. It has separate floating point multiplication and floating point addition data paths. Each floating point operation takes 4 cycle latency. Now let us study its roofline model. So we already told you that, you know, this is the roofline model we have. Of course, this could be our roofline model if our DRAM bandwidth was infinity, but unfortunately that's not. So now let us bound this further. So first we'll discuss computation ceilings. So Opterons have dedicated multipliers and adders. Okay, sometimes we have, you know, FME units which can do fused multiplication and additions. But this Opteron has separate multipliers and adders. Now suppose your application is such that it only needs adders. It only needs adders. It doesn't need multipliers. Then, even though you have multiplier hardware, you can't use it, right? So assuming we have equal number of adders and multipliers, and we are not using multipliers, then the maximum performance we can get is just half. At least this application that I am talking of, it will only achieve half of that performance. And here this logarithmic axis, so you get go one cell down from this, you come here. We call these ceilings, they act like constraints in the performance. Now, Opterons have 128-bit data path. So double precision is 64-bit, right? And we said I said it is two-way SIMD. So if the total width is 128-bit and each operand is 64-bit, so that's why it is two-way SIMD. So if we cannot leverage SIMD, then attainable performance will decrease even further. Right? See, here I'm adding one ceiling on the other. But if there was, suppose this factor was not there, only this factor was there, then from here you will only come to this point. Similarly, on Opterons, we have floating point instruction having a 4 cycle latency. If you do not express 4-way ILP, then performance will drop by as much as 4 times. Right? We have all studied about, you know, pipelining. So if an operation is taking 4 cycles and if you don't have effective pipelining, then you are not committing or you're not completing sufficient number of instructions in each cycle, so your performance will drop. Or if there are dependencies across the instructions, then also pipeline doesn't work efficiently. So in this way, you can see that these bottlenecks bring down the performance a lot. From 64 gigaflops, it has come down to just 4 gigaflops. Now let us see communication ceilings. So we can perform similar exercises by taking away parallelism from the memory subsystem. So here, this is the stream bandwidth, which is probably the maximum bandwidth you can get from DRAM. But again, you know, in the morning you have studied about DRAMs. DRAMs will provide you high bandwidth only when you can leverage the full parallelism. For example, row buffer locality and so on. But if some of those factors are missing, if your application is such that it is making random memory accesses, then there is no locality, then the effective bandwidth goes down. So here I have given just some examples. If there are not explicit software prefetch instructions, then you don't get the full bandwidth. Now opterons are NUMA, which means the memory traffic must be correctly balanced among the two sockets to achieve good stream bandwidth. Right? That means if the data you need is not in the memory of the same NUMA node, but in the memory of the different NUMA node, then it will take much longer latency to get the data. Similarly, if your accesses are not, if they are random or if they are sprided, then also the effective memory bandwidth comes down. Okay, and in the worst case is this, where you have both computation ceilings and communication ceilings. Of course, this is very realistic also. So you have both. So effectively, now your roofline model is just this. You can get very low performance. Okay, your parallelism and bandwidth vectors, all of them come into picture, so effective memory bandwidth comes down greatly. Okay, now, so this was from the figure. Now let us take some numbers. We'll use this Intel's Xeon Phi processors example, which is Knight's Landing. So now, till now, see, we have only talked about DRAM, but you can also consider, because in a processor, we don't have just one level of cache, we have a whole memory hierarchy. So this is the roofline model. If the data you are fetching is all available in the DRAM, if your data is in MCDRAM, so MCDRAM, you can, you know, you can read more about Xeon Phi. I have a separate program there, but MCDRAM is just, it's something like L3 cache, or actually it can be part of the cache or it can be part of the memory. That's why it's called near memory or far memory. So if all the data is available in the MCDRAM, then this is your roofline model. If your data is all available in the L2, then you have a higher roofline. And if you have L1 cache supplying all the data to you, then this is the effective roofline model you will get. And here again, this is your best case performance. This is the performance if you don't have SIMD, and here you don't also have FME. So let us take some numbers. So KNL, Knight's Landing, KNL is the same as Knight's Landing. So here it has a turbo frequency of 1.4 gigahertz. It has a vector width of 8. Right? Now, every core has two VPUs. VPUs, vector processing units. Okay, and in each cycle, each VPU can perform two FMA operations. It can perform one FMA operation, and each FMA operation is counted as two operations because fused multiply and add. So multiplication and addition. So that's why FMA is counted as two instructions. And the overall Xeon Phi here, this model, is 7250, it has 68 cores. So it has 68 cores, each core has two VPU. Each VPU can perform one FMA instruction in each cycle. So that's why it can give you 3 teraflops per second. So this is how you get the peak performance of any computing system. So this is a peak double precision performance. Okay. So this is how you get this number. Now, so this is this 1.4 gigahertz is your maximum frequency, right? But when you are doing SIMD vectorization, then effective frequency is only 1.2 gigahertz. And if your load is very, very heavy, you can't go beyond 1.2 gigahertz. So if effective frequency is only 1.2 gigahertz, the performance comes down from 3000 to just 2600. Similarly, if there is no ILP, then you can't use both the VPUs, you can't use FM instructions. Right? So here you have just 68 cores. You are able to use SIMD, but you're not able to use VPUs and FMA, so then further it comes down. And if you're also not able to use SIMD, then again, it goes down further. So this is the peak performance you can get. Your application will not even achieve this much. It may achieve even much less than this. Okay, now, So now that we have understood the importance of achieving high level of instruction level parallelism, now let us come to the side of the application or the code. Let us see from code perspective. Here we have seen the numbers of peak performance. Now let us look at the code. So here we have already shown that it is important to exploit ILP to achieve high performance. Now let us study loop unrolling approaches and their impact. Okay, so this is a for loop, I'm sure everybody knows. So now there are two strategies of doing loop unrolling. This is one strategy. This is another strategy. So here, for example, suppose this loop I goes from I equals to 0 to 99. That means it has 100 iterations. And here we make it just 50 iterations and we just unroll it. Sum plus equals to A and sum plus equals to A B of I plus B. And here again, we make just 50 iterations, but instead of sum, we just have two different variables, sum 0 and sum 1. And of course, at the end, we will have to add sum 0 to sum 1 and have a single variable. But in each unrolled loop iteration, we have two variables. Here we have one variable. Apart from this part, both the codes are same. Okay, so I'm sure you must have heard of what is loop unrolling. So I'm doing loop unrolling in two different ways. Here I have only one variable, sum, and here I introduce two variables, sum 0 and sum 1. So which of the two loops lead to higher ILP? Can a student, any student tell us? Can you think which of the loops will lead to higher or which of them will allow us to exploit this instruction level parallelism more effectively?
Okay,
so N Krishna. So yeah, can you tell why?
Because there are two variables, we can add the first instruction and second instruction in parallel maybe, because there's two different variables, sum 0 and sum 1.
Yeah. So here in A, the variable sum is used in all the statements, and here in B, different partial sums are used for storing the sums. So here in B, actually there is no dependency. Of course, sometimes you can have intelligent compiler which can recognize that effect, you don't need it to be same. It will introduce a temporary variable, but assuming a normal compiler, this with, if you try to do, you know, pipelining, then here the same variable sum, you will have to read it and then you have to update it. So it will lead to dependency. That's why this and this cannot be scheduled in parallel, whereas here they can be easily scheduled in the parallel. So now you can see that just slight care in doing the loop unrolling can help you get much, much more performance. If a processor has super scale capability, then code B can achieve high performance by running these instructions in parallel. So to summarize, we studied here computation and communication ceilings. We took example of KNN, and we also did this solved example on how do we achieve different degrees of instruction in parallelism. Okay, so can you please stop the recording and we move on to the next PPT?
Sure, sir.